Welcome everyone to our Sunday worship led by me, Paul Coburn, on behalf of Sleaford Methodist Circuit. And we'll begin today with a prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we praise you because you are the source of all that is good and true. And you are the source of life itself. We can plan, we can build, and we can make many things, but only you can create. Only you can create out of nothing. Only you can give life to what you have made. Father, we praise you that from the very beginning it was your intention that we should not only have life, but that we should have life that is real and full and free. We praise you that in Christ you have shown us the lengths to which you were prepared to go so that we should have new life. We praise you that in him and through his utter commitment to your purpose and his obedience to your will, you have left us in no doubt as to your love and mercy towards us. We praise you that this new life you have for us has no end. It is not limited by time or eternity. Wonderful God, we praise you for that love, which will never let us off, never let us down, and never let us go, until we have entered into that life which is filled with the power of the Spirit. We praise you now and forever for our life in Christ. Amen. Let's join in the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we're going to sing our praise now with the hymn, O Heavenly King, Look Down From Above. Our reading today is the set gospel lesson for this Sunday, and it's from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 1 to 11. On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Dear woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My time has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." This, the first of his miraculous signs, Jesus performed at Cana in Galilee. He thus revealed his glory, and his disciples put their faith in him. Thanks be to God for his word. I'm going to look at that story from three different angles. The first two, very briefly. We're going to have an imaginative interpretation, a nice simple interpretation, and then something a little more challenging. And the first two, as I say, very brief. The imaginative one is one I came across many years ago now, given by a teetotaler whose understanding of this story was that when the master of ceremonies tasted the liquid that had been drawn from the water jars and proclaimed that it was better than anything that he had yet drunk that evening, the best was saved till last. What he was tasting was not some miraculous transformation of water into wine, but what he was tasting was pure water. But it was so refreshing and so much better than that evil alcohol that he'd been imbibing all evening that he was bowled away by the purity and excellence of the taste. So in a teetotaler's interpretation of this, nothing actually happened to the water, but it proves that water is better than even the best wine. It's imaginative in its interpretation. I don't think for a moment that this is what John was intending us to understand from this parable. Not parable, this story, this miracle, this sign that Jesus had performed. So I tell it more for amusement than anything else. A simple understanding of this parable, I keep calling it a parable, of this incident, is that Jesus took something ordinary and everyday, water, and transformed it into something wonderful and rich and spectacular and special, the best wine that this particular master of ceremonies had ever drunk. And I can quite see that that could be John's message, because it certainly fits in with some of the other messages that you get in his gospel. Jesus said, according to John's gospel, "I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Not just for people to exist, but them to have rich life, eternal life. And that word isn't applied in John just to the quantity of life. It goes on forever, but it's all about a quality of life. And this first sign of Jesus is a symbol of that, taking our ordinary existence and making it wonderful, special, extraordinary. It's a wonderful message. And if you want a simple message of what Jesus can do for you and your life, well, there you have it. Jesus can transform your ordinary existence into something special. The Carpenters, with their song Top of the World, I think express this beautifully. I'm on the top of the world, looking down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I've found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me on top of the world. There is wonder in most everything I see, is another line from that same song. And that's what life is like when lived with Christ. He transforms the ordinary into the wonderful. Simple message, if that speaks to you and if that inspires you to get to know Jesus better, go with it, stick with it, and skip on to the end of my talk, because perhaps that's all you need to hear. But if you want something a little more challenging, then stick with me. The interpretation that I really want to look at today is through not the miracle itself, but the conversation that happened beforehand between Jesus and his mother. John never actually names Jesus's mother in his gospel. It's always just the mother of Jesus, but we know her name. It's Mary. Presumably, John was more focused on that relationship rather than her name. But I'll call her Mary, even though Jesus calls her woman, which seems a bit derogatory. The New International Version softens it a bit with dear woman, but the actual word in the Greek is just simply woman. Anyway, it's a conversation with Mary. And there's three parts to it. Firstly, Mary draws the attention of Jesus to an issue, a problem. They have no wine. Secondly, Jesus is reluctant to do anything about it. Why do you involve me in this? He says, my time hasn't come yet. And then thirdly, Mary speaks not to Jesus again, but to the servants to say, do whatever he tells you. So what do we make of that conversation? And it strikes me that it is very like our relationship with Jesus in prayer, or if you like, our relationship with God, who we pray to through Jesus. Because certainly that first bit is what we do when we pray for other people. There are all kinds of prayers. I'm thinking now particularly of what we call prayers of intercession, where we are praying on behalf of someone else. We draw God's attention to a problem. And usually in our prayers, it's a lot more serious problem than I'm at a party and they have no wine. It's usually something much more important than that we bring in our prayers. It may be that we see something on the news about a nation in turmoil, and our prayer to God is they have no peace. They have no medicine, no health. They have no food. There are children, millions of children starving. There are families whose livelihoods have been ruined and torn apart by this conflict. This is an unmitigated disaster, Lord. We draw attention to the issue, the problem. And it may be something a little more personal. It may be a close friend who we say, Lord, they have no freedom from pain. They have no peace in their life. They're full of anxiety. They can't cope anymore. their life is falling apart. We address God with the problem. We draw it to his attention. That's what prayer is, surely. And that's step one of this conversation. The challenging bit is the next bit of the conversation, where Jesus says, what's that got to do with me? What's that got to do with you? The New International Version has it, why do you involve me? The literal translation is, what is it to you? What is it to me? Apparently that was some kind of idiom that means something along the lines of, what's that got to do with me? Why are you saying this? Why involve me? And then he says, my hour has not yet come. There's a timing issue. So there are two slightly different things going on here. And within the context of the story, I don't find that too problematic, because Jesus was human, as well as being divine, as well as being God, the Son, the Word made flesh. He was very human, and he had human emotions and thoughts. And maybe what we're seeing here is basically an instinctive human reaction. Why am I being involved in this issue about wine running out at a party? It's nothing to do with me. And in any case, he says, my time hasn't come. Even in saying that, he's acknowledging that he could do something, but it's not the right moment. He's not feeling that this is the moment in which he reveals his glory, that he actually goes public with who he is and what he's able to do. But it's not really a major issue, this, because in the end, he does sort it out. He addresses the issue. He solves the problem in a wonderful, spectacular way, which John calls his first sign of who he is. And it reveals his glory. And it reminds me of the story that Jesus himself told about a father who asked two sons to do a particular job. And the first son he asked said he wasn't going to do it, but later he changed his mind and he did. The second son said that he would do it, but never got round to it. Which of the two obeyed his father's wishes? Well, the one who did it, not the one who just talked about it. So in the end, the fact that Jesus did act and did solve the issue, that's surely more important than his initial, well, it's not quite the right time attitude. So within the context of the story, not a real problem. But if we see this as an indication of God's nature and God's response to our prayer, I do find that disturbing. Not because I feel this is not the kind of God that I want to believe in, a God who is reluctant to answer prayer. That's concerning enough. What is more disturbing is that this seems to be how God does answer prayer. In my experience, and I suspect in your experience too, there have been many occasions when, through prayer, I've drawn attention to a problem and God does nothing about it. Admittedly, we don't actually hear God say to us, what's this got to do with me? My time hasn't come yet. But it's as if he says that. His very inaction is saying that. The very fact that he does nothing about it suggests that that's his response. He doesn't care. And if he did care, it's not the right time. That's the challenging bit. So, what do we make of this? If we see this as indicating the kind of response that God would make. Well, let's look at it in the two parts. The first bit is when Jesus literally says, what has this to do with me? What has this to do with you? We could answer that very effectively. We say to God, Lord, there are millions of children starving. They have no food. And if we think God is saying, what's that got to do with me? Then our response is, well, of course it's got something to do with you. You're God. You created these people. You have a responsibility towards them. You are a loving God and a caring God. You've always said that you love your people. Well, when they're starving, you should take an interest. You should do something about it, not just sit back and watch and wash your hands of the whole thing. You're God. Of course you should care about it. Of course it's your responsibility. And if we believe God is saying, and what's it to do with you? Again, we've got an answer. Look, God, you created me in your image. You've given me compassion and love. And my way of expressing that is to show that I care when I see people suffering. It's how you've made me. What do you expect me to do? Of course I care. Of course it's an issue. Of course it's something I worry about. Of course it's something I want to bring to you. So we've got answers to those questions, and I can imagine that we could get very vehement and very emotional in expressing those answers, as I just have attempted to indicate. But then I wonder whether actually these questions perhaps are a bit like the detective questioning someone about a murder. I've seen many examples of detective programs where a simple, straightforward question gets a very angry and emotional response. The detective says, "Where were you at 11 o'clock last night?" And the response is, "How dare you ask me that? Are you accusing me of murder? Do you think I had anything to do with it? I love that person. I would never hurt them. I would never hurt a fly. How dare you accuse me of this? I want my lawyer. I'm not saying anything until we get a lawyer here. And until then, get out. I'm not answering your question. Why was I at 11 o'clock last night? Indeed, how dare you?" That sort of thing happens in detective programmes. And as a viewer, I sometimes think, come on, don't get so worked up. It's the police's job to ask where people were at the time of the murder. If you're someone who's connected in any way with the victim, of course, the police need to know where you were. You don't have to get on your high horse and get all emotional about it. They're just asking, where were you? Tell them where you were. I wonder whether this is that kind of question. When God says, what's this got to do with me? And what's this got to do with you? Maybe he's just asking it as a straight question. We don't have to get indignant about that and think that means God doesn't care. He just wants us to clarify, why are you telling me this? What are you expecting me to do about it? What in particular are you wanting to happen here? And why do you care about it? What's your part in this? Maybe God is just challenging us to do more than just name a problem. Here's a problem, Lord. Sort it out. Maybe he wants us to think it through. How do we want to sort him out? How does he get involved? How should we be involved? What's our role in this? So maybe the questioning, what's this got to do with me? What's this got to do with you? Is something that we can actually explore in the way we pray. But then the second bit, my hour is not yet come. It's not the right time. And that, again, seems often to be the way God responds to our prayers. It's not that he says yes or no. He just says, not yet. I'm not going to deal with this right now. At least that's what his silence seems to indicate. And the fact is, God has his plans. He has his ideas about what's the right moment to act and what isn't. And we have to honour that and respect that and leave him to act in his own time. It might not be the timing that we want, but it's his time. Which leads us to why we pray then. If we say to God, there's a problem here, and God just says, well, it's not the right time, why do we bother? Because sometimes it is the right moment. sometimes the miracle happens. Sometimes it can be an extraordinary answer to prayer. Sometimes it could be quite simple. We address a situation in a nation that's suffering through war or famine or whatever. And then we see on the news that there's a charity working there, and we hear someone talking about the good that they've done and the help that they've brought. And it reminds us, well, yes, something's going on there. There is help being offered. Maybe we turn the page in the newspaper and we find an advert which is an appeal for help to help that exact crisis that we've just been praying about. And that brings us into it. How can we help? What could we give in that situation? There are all kinds of ways in which God can start to answer these prayers. And if it's a personal thing with a friend, again, maybe it's that we speak to the friend and discover actually things have got a little better. They've had a change in medication and that's helped. Or perhaps a cancelled appointment at the hospital has been replaced with someone else cancelling, and they have the opportunity to go instead, and good things could happen. And I know you could say, and the sceptic would say, it's all just down to luck. You know, we pray and something happens, or it doesn't happen, and if it happens, it's just luck, nothing to do with God. But we know in our hearts when these things happen that God is paying attention, that these are answers to prayer. Somehow we know that this is God at work. But how do we make that happen? How do we get beyond those first two parts of the conversation where we draw attention to God, to the issue, to God, and then God says, well, it's not yet time? How do we get beyond that? Mary didn't argue back with Jesus. All she did was turn to the servants and say, do what he says. I've often wondered about that. Why does she need to do that? They were servants, weren't they? So didn't they have to do what people told them? Why does Mary have the authority to delegate her authority to Jesus? It doesn't quite make sense. Although, I don't know, maybe Mary was a better known to the servants than Jesus was. Maybe she was a friend of the family and they knew her better than Jesus, and therefore, you know, she needed to say, look, you know, this is my son, you know, you do what I was going to ask you to do, well, do what he says. I don't know. But the servants represent Mary's resources that she was able to offer to the situation. And ultimately, what she does is put her trust in Jesus. Say, okay, the ball's in your court now. Over to you. These are the resources you've got to work with. She doesn't argue. She doesn't try and persuade. She trusts Jesus to do the right thing. And he does. And maybe that's where we go with this. After God seems to be saying, not yet, well, we just have to trust him. We have to leave it in his hands and trust that he does care. He will take responsibility. He will act when the time is right. But we have to trust him. And this is not to be taken as a way of getting the prayers answered. If we approach it with that attitude and think, well, Mary trusted Jesus and the miracle happened, so if we trust Jesus, the miracle will happen, that's bad thinking. That ends up leading to the fact that the miracle will only happen if we trust enough, if our faith is strong enough. And that's a very dangerous thing when we start believing that God is not answering prayers because we don't have enough faith. It's good to have faith. It's good to put our trust in Jesus, but it's not our faith that does the miracle. It's God's actions through Jesus that does the miracle. So why we trust Jesus is because it's the right thing to do, because we should. Whatever comes, whether the miracle then happens or not, we put our trust in Jesus, but we also put at his disposal what resources we have. And that's unlikely to be a bunch of servants, unless we happen to be very rich people and have servants at our disposal. And I don't imagine that will apply to many of those who are viewing this. But we do have other things. We have money, we have time, we have particular skills and experience. We have our energy and our effort that we can put into things. We have our very lives that we could and should put at the disposal of Jesus if we really trust him. So that's the end part of the prayer. We draw attention to an issue. Look, God, this is the issue. This is what people are lacking. This is how people are feeling. This is some issue that you need to address. We perhaps spend a little while exploring that, telling God what we want him to do and wondering what our part in all this is. But we end by leaving it with God. That's not to say we don't return to the same prayer again on another occasion, but we leave it with God for the moment. We say, Lord Jesus, we trust you. And here are my resources. And if I can be any help in this, well, here I am. Use me. If we're not prepared to say that, how serious are we about our prayer? So let's do that now. Let's pray in that way for an issue that we are concerned about. What I'm going to do now is suggest your prayers and then leave a gap so that you can offer your own prayers. And I'll leave three different gaps. And I realise that you know how long you need for these gaps. You know more than I do how long it will take for your prayers. So rather than leave just too long a gap on the video, I'm going to leave about 20 seconds each time, which isn't really that long. But towards the end of that, I'll flash up a little thing at the bottom that says pause now. If you need more than 20 seconds for each bit of this prayer, press the pause button, stop the video, and take whatever time you need in that prayer. And then restart it. Okay? I'm also going to suggest at the beginning that you think of a topic, something to pray for, and if more than one comes to mind, well, do this exercise more than once, either using the video to prompt you, or it's easy enough just to do it in your own head, I hope, once you get the idea. Okay, so let us pray. And first, think of an issue that's on your mind at the moment. It may be a world issue, something that really disturbs you and really tears your heart. It may be a friend or a family issue and an individual person. Don't try and think of lots, just think of one. And as I say earlier, come back to others later and repeat this prayer with the other issues. But just for now, think of one issue and tell God what that issue is. Bring it to his attention. Now imagine that God is challenging you. What's this got to do with me? What's this got to do with you? Why are you bringing this to God? What are you expecting God to do about it? Be specific what you would like him to do. How are you involved in this? Why do you care? Again, tell him that. Maybe you've got things that you could do, and be honest about that. Just explore the issue a bit more, rather than just presenting it as a problem. What is it that you and God might be able to do between you? And now get ready to leave this with Jesus. Think of what resources you've got that might actually be of some help. Or maybe you need just to offer to Jesus your whole self, everything you have. But tell him what that is. Tell him what you're prepared to contribute towards this issue for which you are now praying. And then tell him that you trust him and that you're willing to leave it with him. Lord Jesus, you've heard our prayers. We trust you, the one who can turn the ordinary into the extraordinary and do more than we can even imagine. To you be the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. And we're going to sing again. Make me a channel of your peace. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord grant you peace. Amen.